What is I to the power of I? Before we look at that, I want to have a quick look at Euler's identity, and everyone gets very, very excited about e to the I pi, or pi I, whichever way around you want to do it, plus 1 equals 0. Of course, we can rearrange that a little bit. E to the I pi just equals negative 1. And Euler's identity is amazing, don't get me wrong. I think it's incredible. But I believe we can do a lot better. In fact, even Euler's identity, I tend to think of it not like this as one specific case, but as Euler's formula. So this is the generalized form. You've got e to the I theta equals cos theta plus I sine theta. And this is arguably more beautiful than just that one particular case, because what you have here are the two major ways of representing complex numbers. The e to the I theta, that theta is just the angle around. It's the polar coordinate version of a complex number, and you can scale that in and out to get everywhere on the complex plane. And then underneath here, the cos theta plus I sine theta, that's just the Cartesian coordinate. So I like this because it's converting between the polar and the Cartesian versions of complex numbers. We can now put some values in for theta and we get some fantastic identities. If our angle is pi on 2, e to the I pi on 2 equals I. Pretty straightforward. Here's the famous one. If we go through a full 180 degrees, e to the I pi equals negative 1, but we can carry on. E to the I 3 pi on 2 equals negative I. That's kind of fun. And finally, e to the I 2 pi just equals 1, although you could argue I shouldn't just use 2 pi for that, should I? I mean, really, because it's also the angle 0. So there are two values going on here. And I guess the other issue is, because theta is an angle, you loop back on yourself. So you could carry on. E to the I 5 pi on 2 also equals I. We've got two versions of that, and that's fine. So here we have all the fantastic identities, including the particularly famous one over there, but it's just examples of Euler's formula. What I want to look at is the much more exciting calculation of what is I to the power of I. What is the imaginary number to the power of the imaginary number? Is it going to be complex? Is it going to be real? Is it just in terms of I? Is it a whole new type of number? Again, so to work it out, our big issue here is prying apart the I in the base from the I in the power. I'm going to use a little trick to do that. I'm going to do a kind of a function on I to the I, and then I'm going to do the inverse of that. So for example, I could square it and then take the square root, and we're back where we started. Or I could take the inverse of the inverse, or I could take e to the power of the natural log. And in theory, we'll still get the value of I to the I at the other end. There's a few dangers, because things like, if we square it and take the square root, if I to the I happens to be a negative value, then we'll lose that. So there are some nuances to keep an eye on, but for the most part, this is a pretty powerful technique. We're going to actually use e to the natural log of I to the I. And we're doing that because with a logarithm, if you've got something to the power of something inside it, you can take the exponential, you take the power and pop it out the front. And that's how we're going to crack the two i's apart. We now just have to work out what is the natural log of I. Well, we saw that a moment ago when we were doing our ridiculous things on the complex plane. So just the screen's getting a little crowded here. And we can just read off from before that e to the I pi on 2 equals I, and the natural logarithm is just whatever you have to raise e to get the value. So to get I, e is to the power of I pi on 2. So we take that and we pop it over in there. So the natural logarithm, we've got two i's next to each other. The imaginary number times the imaginary number is negative 1 by definition. So we swap that out for a negative. And there you have it. I to the power of I equals e to the negative pi on 2. How cool is that? I mean, I think that is an incredible result. The imaginary number to the imaginary number is e to the negative pi on 2. Now, what's partly so exciting about that is everything on the right-hand side over there is a real number. So we can slap some values in there, and it turns out that I to the I equals 0.207879 and a bunch of other digits after that. So it's about a fifth. That's the moral of this video. I to the I is about 1/5. The other fascinating thing about this is, yes, people go on and on about Euler's identity because it's got negative values in there. It's got e, it's got pi, it's got the imaginary number, and it's got powers. But to my mind, I to the I has all of those things. It's got powers, e, pi, I. It's also got, it's got a fraction. That depends how you define your circle constant, to be honest. We should have a value of pi, which is half the normal value. How great would that, would just solve a lot of arguments. And, you know, negative numbers, it's all there. What I like even more is on the left is completely imaginary. I to the I, no real numbers. On the right is completely real. And people think that, you know, imaginary numbers are kind of an add-on, a bonus, exotic type of number. No, they're perfectly valid numbers. The word imaginary is not a great name, if I'm being entirely honest. And people, you know, you're aware that if you square I, you get a completely real answer. So people are vaguely aware there is a link between the imaginary and the real numbers. But here, nothing but imaginary gives you nothing but real. They are all the same type of number. So there you are. That's my video about I to the power of I. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for everyone who subscribes to my... Ah, kidding. Of course I'm going to talk about the bonus values. So people are already yelling at their screens. I didn't point out, because of the way I did the natural log of I, it's got more than one valid result, as well as pi on 2. I could have used 5 pi on 2. I could have used 9 pi on 2. There are loads, just loads of, you know, infinitely many, some would say, options. And the solution here, when it comes to this little problem, is, don't worry about it. Just, it's about a fifth. So there you are. Thanks for watching the video. If you want to learn more about Euler's identity, then 3 Blue, 1 Brown has some fantastic videos. Both the very first video that was on the channel and the one that was done 2 years afterwards. Please do check those out if you want to learn more about my second favorite ridiculous identity involving these constants.